All right, thank you very much. I'm really happy to be here, not only for the opportunity, but also physically, because I've been sick for the last week. So luckily I got, more healthy yesterday, and I'm able to present here and able to present Web Components to you. But probably because you're wondering, who am I? Hi, I'm Tim van der Lippe. I've been a Google developer expert. Then I became a Google intern at the Polymer team, and right now I'm a remote Polymer team member. So I do work with the Polymer team, but they are located in San Francisco, and I'm located here in the Netherlands because I'm still a master's student, computer science, at Delft University of Technology here in the Netherlands. So that's my background, and the organizers asked me to give a presentation about Polymer. So I thought about that, and I said, okay, no, I'm not going to talk about Polymer. Instead, I'm going to talk about the web component standards that empower Polymer to be what Polymer does. So there are three accepted standards that have shipped, templates, custom elements, and Shadow DOM. They have shipped in Chrome, Opera, Safari. Firefox is coming in the very next version, so in a month or two, we will have that. And Edge, they're working on it. And these standards are what Polymer is based upon. So Polymer uses these standards. They have been working on them for a long time, a really long time. And now, finally, they are coming to the modern browsers. So in this presentation, I want to show these standards to you, what they are, what problems they actually solve, also what problems they do not solve, because that's very important to realize that these are not golden solutions. They are good for particular solutions. And I will show some examples of how you would use them together. So let's do a deep dive into the first one, which is the template element. And the template element has been here for quite a while, actually. It has shipped for a long time in Chrome already. And also other browsers have this, except IE. That's the only one. But there's a polyfill for that. So we have this template element. And it's basically a blueprint. So you have this template element, and you put some DOM in it. And what does it do? Well, this DOM is so-called inert. It doesn't participate actively in the current DOM tree. So what does this mean? That any link or image or anything is not loaded. It's hidden in this DOM tree, and we can reuse it later. So it's basically a blueprint that we can reuse later. And why was this created? Because we have, in the past year, switched from server-side rendering, where we create a lot of HTML, send this to the browser, and then render it, now to a client-side approach, where we send all our logic, and then based on the data, we create the DOM on the fly. So this change in how we build website caused some challenges, because there were some current APIs that you can still use to create DOM. For example, we have the inner HTML property, where you can assign a string, and then on this node, it will have this DOM nodes in it. So we have string here, and it will create the DOM nodes for you. In a similar fashion, we have the JavaScript APIs. So it's a lot of code you see here. You probably are not writing this exact code. You're using an abstraction like JSX, where we abstract away. But in the end, you're using these APIs to build DOM. And they work. I mean, we have been using them. But there are a couple of problems, and mostly performance problems. Because, for example, in inner HTML, we have to parse the string every single time. The browser doesn't know that even though you know that the string hasn't changed because we only changed one property, the browser doesn't know and has to parse the whole string again and again and again. And that's very expensive. Similarly, for document.createElement and its various APIs, we are in the JavaScript realm. And by definition, the JavaScript realm is more expensive than if we would parse the HTML in the C++ realm. So a browser can more easily parse, so that's less expensive, than if we would do it in JavaScript. But parsing every single time is also detrimental to performance problems. And both of these solutions still have to manipulate the DOM. So you still have to change the DOM tree based on what you do, what you change, and then we have to update the DOM and paint a new screen. So these performance problems were there, and now we have this new template element. So what does it do? Well, we can create an element with the JavaScript API that we had, we can pass on inner HTML to this template. But the difference is the very last line, which says template.content.cloneNode. And in this case, the content represents the DOM that we wrapped, that was inert at the beginning. And we are cloning it instead. And what happens is that every time we want to create DOM using this method, we are not parsing, and we are not calling JavaScript APIs. So we are parsing first for the template, that's one. But every time we want to create DOM, we are not parsing again. And because of this, the template element is really fast at creating DOM. I did a benchmark on these common ways of creating DOM, and I put template content on the baseline. So that's 100%. And then I use the same functions and properties that we had before, like inner HTML and create element, to see how fast are they compared to template. And you can see here that inner HTML is actually 3 times as slow as template, because this parsing cost that we pay every single time costs this much. We still have the DOM manipulation, but the parsing time here is 66%. Create element is faster. It's about 2 times as slow as template element, because this JavaScript is actually quite optimized. The browser is quite fast at it, but still, we are limited. And even if we create abstractions on top of that, where we're calling functions, so we have these closures that we have to take care of, all this state, we are paying a cost, and we are almost as slow as inner HTML. So this template content is really fast at creating DOM element, and it has it doesn't have the performance problems that we had before with inner HTML document create element. So when to use this template element? Well, if you have something that's based on a template, where you have the same DOM definition as you would always have. And this is usually the case with any component, where the component has a definition, and that definition doesn't change. And it's usually cheaper to then update the DOM after the fact. So we create a lot of DOM, which is usually a lot of static stuff, and then do some targeted updates for our data. But template is not like the golden solution, because if you're only creating DOM once, you just use inner HTML. There's no reason to not do that. And similarly, if the template that you were using was actually a lot of dynamic parts, these DOM updates will be the bottleneck. So I suspect that most of the components that you define that are based on this template, the template will actually be the fastest way to create this DOM, rather than inner HTML or document.createElement. But do measure, of course. So take a look. You've probably seen template, but I haven't seen a lot of people using the content.cloneNode. So please try it out and see how performant it is for you. That's the first standard. And the second one is actually Shadow DOM. And Shadow DOM is probably new to most of you, because it's a new concept. We haven't had it before. But I will actually show you that it has been, ever since you've been writing a website, that you have been using Shadow DOM. Because Shadow DOM is actually used in a native element. So here we have a video element. Video has a simple source. I took a random video on the internet. And if you inspect this video, you see these two HTML DOM nodes. And that's it. But if you look more closely, we have all these controls here at the bottom, which are still there. And I will show you right now that these are actually just DOM nodes. If you enable user agent Shadow DOM, you will see what's in the Shadow DOM of a video element, and you will see the inputs and the diffs that are in a video element. You've probably never seen it before. Actually, I have only seen it because I had to make this slide. But it has always been there. And now, if you think about this and you see this input and this diffs here, you're probably thinking, I've never seen a video element break. Whenever I use it, it just works. So there are some properties of this Shadow DOM that you've implicitly have been using, because these CSS rules, if you ever have styled a diff, which you probably have if you're a front-end developer, you've never seen the video element break. It didn't break for some reason. And it also hides these implementation details, because it is very probable that this is the first time you have actually seen the DOM of a video element. So these two properties have been there of the Shadow DOM, but you've never actually used it. And if you want to have this yourself, like you as a user want to have these properties, you couldn't. You had to use a convention like BEM to make sure that there are no conflicts, or you were using a runtime class generation mechanism where we would deduplicate and make them unique such that it wouldn't clash. But there were still solutions where the browser had no mechanic for you. You had nothing in the browser that would prevent you from making these clashes. You just had to pray that your site worked, and you had reasonable assumptions that it would work based on these conventions or class generation, but that's it. So now we have this Shadow DOM, which is actually called user-exposed Shadow DOM. So this is the new standard, and this user-exposed means that you, as a developer, can create this Shadow DOM as well. So we have two new things. The first one is a new method called attachShadow on any element that you have. And the second one is a property, ShadowRoot. And ShadowRoot is to get the Shadow DOM that you create with attachShadow. So let's see, how does it work? Well, let's first create any element. So I took a div, just for reasons. And I call attachShadow on it. So now this div has a Shadow DOM. And we can use it on the very next line, where we assign some DOM. So in this case, we have this div. It has some Shadow DOM. And in this Shadow DOM, we define a style on a span. And we have this span in there, which is in Shadow DOM. And now when we append this Shadow DOM div to the browser, we will see that this in Shadow DOM has a red color, but all other spans in the browser, in your current web page, are unaffected. And that's the property of Shadow DOM. You create a boundary around your element and make sure that nothing leaks out of it and doesn't leak into it. And there's some other implementation benefits of it. Because we have these scopes, whenever you change some DOM, like you add a class or you remove a DOM, style calculations will be really fast in the browser. Because the browser knows, hey, this is a Shadow DOM, and I know I can't be affected from the outside. I just have to check what style's in here, and that's it. So instead of these very large CSS files that you would create, which is thousands of lines, that the browser would have to check every single line, are you affected? Do I need to do something? Now the browser only has to check inside this boundary what has changed and do a very quick update. And moreover, because you know that the Shadow DOM is there, you can create very simple selectors. I've not been a front-end developer for that long. I've been using these standards because I thought they were ever there. And I've been writing CSS like diffs and spans and just that and thought, yeah, it just worked. But I now realize that that's a property of Shadow DOM that I could use, but if I would not have that, I would just break every single thing. And that's important to realize if you're building a website, whether you're using these scopes or not, and how these styles affect each other. So if you want to use Shadow DOM, do use it. If you want to encapsulate this DOM and prevent this styling, and to have these other performance benefits that you would have with these performance style recalculations. And if you want to hide these implementation details, like we saw with the video element, if you want to prevent anyone from screwing with your component, you can use the Shadow DOM to hide it from them. Now, don't use Shadow DOM all over the place, because you create boundaries for yourself, actually. So the Shadow DOM is nice because it prevents others from breaking your code, but it will also prevent you from changing the code from the outside. So usually, my rule of thought is, whenever I have a component, I make one Shadow DOM, and that's it. So if I have a component definition, it should be reasonably large, like 20 to 50 lines, and that's it, that's one Shadow DOM, and then the others, we just use regular CSS cascading to style all the others. So if you want to use it, please try. And you will see that you can get the same experience as you had with video element and with its input elements and diffs in it. So these are two standards, the template element, which has been there, and you probably have seen it. Shadow DOM, you might have implicitly seen. And then we get to the third one, which is custom elements. And that's probably the most groundbreaking standard that there is, because there are a lot of opinions about this one. So yeah, I hear some laughs. it has been quite a while. So I never wondered why the standard has been there, because I've been for a little bit in front-end development and took this for granted. So I actually attended the talk of Alex Russell at the Polymer Summit of last year, where he explained why custom elements is a thing. And he explained Team Parkour. Team Parkour was a research and prototype team, and they investigated in 2010 what the state of the art at that moment was. So they created a state of the art at that moment and then tried to predict, okay, where should we go from there? And mostly they were trying to identify areas that are common, like that would be in every single library because it was not there in the browser. So he showed some code. I took these literal examples from him. This is apparently jQuery components. I've never seen it. And I never realized this was a thing back then. It seemed kind of readable. I could understand what it is doing, but that's about it. And then he showed Clojure. Props if you can read this and understand what it's doing. I don't understand it. It's a lot of stuff. And apparently, it does the same thing, just in a different way. And then we have Dojo, which is, again, something. And it does, again, the same thing. And we still have the same thing. So this is a lot of code where we've seen a lot of different patterns. And we just have the same thing. Opinionated, though. So then I made this slide where I was like, OK, wait, do we still have this? So I looked into Angular React and Vue and saw, and to my best recollection, made some comparisons of these callbacks. And most of them are actually still doing the same. You still have these component lifecycles in every single library, just a different name and maybe a slightly different timing as well, but doing the same. And then I've been using these native custom element definitions, which are, again, the same. So what have been doing so far? And then I realized we have this XKCD. You probably know. We have all these lifecycle standards. And now we have this custom elements thing, which is yet another standard. What have we been doing? Now, the difference here, though, is that custom elements is a standard and is implemented in the browser. And the other standards were implemented in a JavaScript environment. And this is a fundamental difference, because now the browser actually does the state management, the component management, instead of a JavaScript library that would do it for you. So this has been a trend overall, where custom elements is one of the things that the browser now does, which previously were user-land solutions. So we had custom elements, but we had no template before, and previously it would be there inert in the DOM by a display none, and it would just do nothing, sit there, but it would still render in the tree. And the shadow DOM was with these user conventions and runtime class generations, but the browser had none until we had shadow DOM. Similarly, in JS, you've seen the component examples before, and actually, there were classes. They were inheriting from something else, and we had these magic strings that would look up the definitions, where it was actually inheritance of classes. We have seen promises and async await to do async calling. We had CSS variables, which was previously in a preprocessor, where you had to pre-generate on the fly in a build step, and then transfer this CSS to the browser, whereas now the browser has the CSS variables in it. And even with web animations, where the browser now has web animations, which would previously be JavaScript functions with timeouts and intervals and all that. So all these standards are meant to take something that was previously a user-land solution that was not opinionated per se, and now integrated into the browser. And that's how you should view custom elements as well. So these browser standards are for usability, but also to ship less non-important JavaScript code, because these component definitions and this management code is not very interesting. You want to have opinions about data propagation and how you define them, but not about the actual management. That's a boring problem, and it's actually a lot of maintenance to make this right. So we have all this, and now we have this custom element. So I want to show one example of a custom element which works in any browser. So what we have to do is, well, we have this class because we are inheriting from HTML element. That's our base class. And then we have to define this custom element at the bottom with custom elements.define with a name and the class. So this is how you would use it in regular HTML up at the top. And what do we have? Well, we have some callbacks. For example, the connected callback and disconnected callback to know when a node is attached or detached. And we have a constructor, a regular constructor. And we can do some setup work here. For example, create a shadow DOM. And now we have a working component in one slide that works in any browser as soon as they implement it, which is Firefox in a couple of months, but it would work in Chrome, Opera, and Safari. So if you want to use custom elements, I would say if you have any component and you want to work it on the web without any libraries, you can use the standard and it would just work. Now, of course, the developer experience for this is less nice. So it's also nice as a base layer for library or authors. So if you want to create a library which has an opinionated usage or definition of data propagation, you can use these callbacks to solve a problem you don't want to solve at this moment. You want to talk about data propagation and use any solution that you like and take these component management for granted. And to have some interoperability between components, because we have had these components before, like React, Angular, Vue, but because they were just a little bit different, they couldn't work together. They were just completely different for the browser, and you could never make this work. And now we're with small libraries, you could use the same definition and make sure that they are workable at the same time. Now, of course, custom elements are for components. So if you're not writing a component, do not use custom elements. It makes no sense. Just use a regular object or a class or anything. And only if you need these callbacks, if you need this lifecycle, then use the custom elements spec. So if we take all these three standards and we want to combine them together, we can make one actually useful web component. So here we have a profile picture with an attribute picture with a value of a user. And what we want to show is this picture rounded on the screen. And we can put this anywhere on the website because we have many places where this shows up. So let's see. Okay, we need a component, so we need the custom elements. So we create a class, we define it. Now we need to create some DOM. And because we have this component and we want to put it on many places and the definition doesn't change, I can use a template to create this DOM efficiently. So in here, I will create a style for the image to make it round and to have the actual image. And the image will not load until you will actually create it. So in this constructor, we will create shadow DOM because I define some style and I don't want to clutter every single image and make it round. And I create, I clone the template content and attach it to the shadow DOM. And then I can query it to get the actual image because we need to listen to changes. So I have a picture here, which is an attribute we observe. And whenever we change this attribute, we want to know. So we have this attribute change callback. And in here, I will update the image that I created, queried just before, set the source, and that's it. And it would work. So here you see why these standards, I would use them for the problems that they would solve. I would use template for reusable DOM creation. I would use shadow DOM because I create some style and I don't want to clutter anything else. And I want to use custom element because I'm building a component for the web. But as you've seen, it's quite a lot of code. It's a lot of stuff you have to do before to make it work. And that's where the web component libraries come in. These libraries make it easier for you to use the standards. They use the standards, so the browser will help you, but they will define how you build the component and how they will work together. So we have Polymer as one, but we have Gluon, which is a small subset of Polymer. We have Skate.js, which is like an interoperability layer between React, Angular, Vue, and the standards. And then we have Vadin, which exposes a UI kit. Like Norbert told, they have a lot of components that you can reuse on your website. So we have these web component libraries, and I also want to show one project I did, one investigation I did, into React Image Pro. And React Image Pro was trending on JavaScript subreddit. It looked quite cool, so I looked into it. And essentially, it was a component that took any image on the web, and it could transform it. So it could make it blurry, it could make a red tint, anything you would like to do. It would was using a library for that. So I looked into this, and I read the README, and the README said, and React's component-based model was perfect for hiding all the implementation details in a component. And then I realized, wait a minute, I've been writing web components. So to me, it's just a web component model. Why would you use React in this specific case? So my investigation was, can I do it without React? Is this actually using something that would be unique to React? So what I did, I took the component in React, and I made a translation. So for example, in React, we have this component did mount callback. I changed it to connected callback. Then in React, we had JSX, and I would use a template. And then React had default props, and I was using observed attributes. Then I made this translation. It was almost the same code, and it worked. So what this means is we took this component in one framework, I transformed it, and it would work in any browser because I was using these standards. And in this specific case, this component was not using anything that React specifically defined. If you would define any application components, then that's different because then React and its whole data propagation would play in. But anything that the browser standards would work for you, you can use these standards. And then it all boils down to boils down to interoperability between you and the browser, where you use the standards that the browser can help you with to make more performant code and to use less JavaScript, so less code to ship to the user, to make your site faster as well. So in the end, I talked about template, Shadow DOM, and custom elements, and these are all standards to help you to define these components. But because they are standards, they are low level by design, you can use any library built on top of that to have a nice developer experience. And in the end, ship less code and have less code running in the browser to make faster websites. Ah, that's the slide I was looking for. So in the end, if you want to use web components, ask yourself the question, when should I use web components? Is the problem that I'm facing right now, is there a ready-made solution? Am I creating DOM dynamically based on the same template? Template element is the fastest way. Am I defining any style and want to prevent that from tainting any other element in my website? Then use Shadow DOM. If I define any component that needs these callbacks and needs this setup work, then use custom elements. And all that, then you use the web component standards, and you can use any solution on top of that. Polymer is one of them. Polymer is opinionated in that sense. But you're still using these standards. And that's my take on when to use web components. Thank you very much.